Hey guys, I'm Stephen Lowe, and today we're going over shoulder impingement. I initially wanted to get this video out a couple months ago when Renaissance Periodization had done their video, basically on the exercises and more focusing on it from a rehab perspective, but we're just getting it out now, so enjoy. All right, so shoulder impingement, usually referred to as painful arch syndrome as well. It is usually pain in the shoulder area from mechanical rubbing of the structures. So there's two different types of ways this can happen. Primary impingement, which is the rubbing of the structures underneath the shoulder, and then also secondary impingement, which is usually due to another injury causing secondary impingement symptoms, like the other injury happens, and then you get some dysfunction of the shoulder, which causes rubbing, and it's termed secondary impingement because it's not the main cause. So there's four different types. The first and most common is subacromial impingement, and the acromion of the shoulder is right here in the middle. If you go to the end of your shoulder and feel the bony structure before you get into the soft tissue of the deltoid, that's the acromion. And usually the pain is right underneath this area of the shoulder. Internal impingement is usually seen in overhead throwing athletes who have lost internal range of motion. So, if they've lost internal range of motion, that means their external rotators on the back of the shoulder are very tight. And what that does is when they're tight, it slowly displaces the humeral head or the shoulder backwards in the joint because it's pulling it that way because they're very tight. And when that happens, the shoulder sliding back can impinge or rub on the structures such as the labrum or irritate the posterior capsule that the shoulder resides in and cause pain and dysfunction there. The coracoid process of the scapula is right about here. And doing a lot of transverse movements such as chest flies can sometimes irritate the structures back behind this area, especially with the chest and the deltoid muscles coming into a point there. So that's coracoid impingement. And then suprascapular impingement is the fourth type. And that one is not usually due to the suprascapular muscle, but the nerve that runs through this area, it can get impinged as it comes under the structures there. And that is usually the fourth type of impingement. So I've included a link there if you want to go check them out. It explains these a bit more in detail. But since subacromial is the most common overuse, we're going to cover that, the risk factors for that, and then also the rehab for that, and then we'll go over some of the risk factors on the next slides. So the acromion shape is one of the biggest risk factors. Some can curve down, and that causes potential mechanical rubbing of the structures underneath. At the end of a set and two failure exercises, especially near the end of a workout when you're getting very tired, that is a big risk factor for impingement and the most often a way that people start to get pain and injury underneath there, especially if they're doing too much volume and sets of exercises. And then also potentially risky exercises, some exercises like your upright rows, your behind the neck pull-ups and presses, that can put the shoulder in a potentially risky position since externally rotated and abducted position, which is basically that, is very unstable for the shoulder, so it requires more rotator cuff control, which means it can fatigue sooner, which means it can get injured more easily. Same with upright rows, going up close to failure, there can be more mechanical rubbing in that position. All right, so the general treatment for shoulder impingement is avoiding potentially risky exercises. If you're one where things like upright rows or behind the neck pull-ups can cause some pain and injury there, then obviously avoiding them is helpful. Usually people who have connective tissue issues or lax connective tissues like Ehlers-Danlos syndrome or other things like that, usually if like your fingers bend far back, that means you have loose and lax connective tissue, usually genetic in cause. And generally speaking, exercises that are more risky, such as like your upright rows, behind the neck pull-ups, especially if the shoulder is in a potentially more unstable position, you're more at risk for potential shoulder impingement with those types of conditions. So short rest and a short course anti-inflammatories can be helpful. Usually, since there is pain and inflammation from rubbing up the structures underneath the area, the short course anti-inflammatories can help get down that inflammation, decrease any residual swelling or any irritation of the tissues, since there is too much for it to heal effectively. And then up to about 7 days at most with rest and short course anti-inflammatories. The longer chronic use of anti-inflammatories is a net negative, but a short course like that of rest and anti-inflams before rehab can be very effective. So high rep rotator cuff rehab and scapular exercises are the main rehab resources to solve shoulder impingement. The main reason for this is because the fatigue at the end of sets, you want the endurance in the rotator cuff exercises. So usually you go 15, 20 reps with the rehab exercises, slowly increase the sets and slowly increase the reps over time. And then scapular exercises, because scapular dysfunction can sometimes lead to potential impingement as well. If the scapula is not moving well and the shoulder is, so if the scapular going overhead, for example, is not moving effectively, the scapular humeral rhythm rotates the scapula about 60 degrees and the shoulder going up is about 120 degrees. Since that is the case, if the scapula can't move as well or it doesn't activate as well and move at the right time, then that can cause some rubbing of the structures as it goes up. Finally, getting back into exercises, work slowly back into things. Usually I like to start with about one, maybe two sets of exercises, then with lighter weights, and then slowly build up the sets, and then slowly build up the weights. Usually that helps to ramp people back in. Usually if someone goes straight from rehab to exercise and like a full routine, that can easily irritate the shoulder again. So you want to go slow and steady and build up slowly so we don't have any re-aggravation of the symptoms of shoulder impingement, especially because with the limited space underneath the area, it can cause a kind of a vicious cycle of pain. And then you try to rehab and it goes slow, and then you finally get build back up. And then if you do too much again, it kind of reverses that cycle and you're kind of stuck there. So slow and steady is the name of the game with shoulder impingement rehab. All right, so let's cover some of the different risk factors and why they are risk factors. All right, so acromion shape. There's four different types of acromion. The type 4 is not shown, but it's more of a convex structure. But normal is basically a straight structure of the acromion there. But 2 and 3 have some hooking and then a lot of hooking at the end. And you can see why that is bad for the shoulder. As your shoulder goes up in the socket, the more curved it is, the more risk potential of things rubbing and going up like that. So those are the biggest risk factors for impingement in general. Most of the cases have some type 2 or type 3 rubbing, or somebody is just going like super high volume to failure type of exercises. So if you've had any imaging that shows type 2 or type 3, just be more wary that you are more at risk, and to substitute exercises if needed, or to build up very slowly because of the risk factor that you are for getting shoulder impingement. So type 4, not shown. Like I said, it's more of a convex instead of a curve down. It's kind of a curve up. Can be more at risk if the convex leads to rubbing there, but otherwise more associated with normal structure where it's not an issue. All right, so let's look at why two failure exercises are a potentially big risk factor here. So as you can see, as the shoulder goes up, the rotator cuff muscles start to glide the humerus in the socket. And so you can think of it like this. This is basic roll and glide biomechanics of the shoulder. So if this is the scapula with the socket here, and this is the humeral head or the arm, as it comes up, there is the roll motion. As it goes up like that, you can see it'll roll out of the joint if there's no gliding. So what the rotator cuff muscles do is they're actually positioned a bit lower on the scapula right here. And so they kind of come up like this. And what they can do as the humeral head rolls up like this, they actually glide the humeral head down in the socket at the same time. So as you get a roll up, you get a glide down of the rotator cuff muscles. And as you can see, creates the space there so it doesn't rub against the acromion. So otherwise it would come up and just bump into the acromion. So what this means is obviously you need endurance in the rotator cuff muscles, especially when you're going to failure with exercises or at the end of a workout when you've worked out your shoulder muscles really hard. Having that rotator cuff endurance especially at the end of the workout and to failure is going to help allow the humeral head to keep gliding down in the socket and rotator cuff muscles to keep on pulling it down like that. Otherwise, if the rotator cuff fatigues and your deltoid and other primary movers of the shoulder are much stronger near the end of the set, as you get that roll up, the shoulders are too fatigued to glide it down, so you get more of that mechanical rubbing of the humeral head area underneath the acromion. So that's why high rep rehab is effective for reducing shoulder impingement and why going to failure, especially near the end of a workout, can start to cause impingement, especially if your rotator cuff muscles are undertrained compared to the primary mover muscles of your shoulder. In general, you can train to failure as long as there's no symptoms, and especially with rehab in general, I would avoid training to failure, working back in the compounds at least for the first few weeks. But if things are going well and you're doing effectively, you can start to work back into all those exercises, especially the potentially risky ones. I would only go like once at the failure first and see how it goes over, you know, like the course of a week. But if that's fine, just keep on slowly ramping up the sets and the intensity over time. And you should be able to work back into things safely. Unless you have potentially other risk factors that are playing a role in developing shoulder impingement. So obviously the goal is to stay healthy. So if you are kind of like stuck in a cycle of pain dysfunction with shoulder impingement, just try to find different exercises that work for your body. Not all exercises can work for everybody. So be smart and train safe and hope you learned a lot about shoulder impingement and especially the specific rehab that is done for it.